excellent grace. Praise Him.
Great to be here, isn't it? Just to have a chance to be together as a family, to worship God and to be in His presence. It's a great day. It's a great day to be together. If you're visiting with us, we're just proud to have you here with us. There's cards on the front of the chairs in front of you that if you'll fill that out, we'd love to know that you were here and that you were with us and to be aware of that. You know, we're all on a journey here. And we often fall down as we go along this journey. Some of us, more than the rest of you, have had major tumbles. But you know what? We're here together to help each other pick up, to get up, and to move forward, and to continue that journey. And that journey is to worship our God, to be disciples of our Savior, and that's what we want to do together. So if you join us in that journey, we would love for you to do that. Another thing that we do along that journey is we have a mission down in Ecuador, the Hacienda of Hope. I know many of you are aware of that. Some of you may not be. And, you know, we started that years and years ago, and I think some of the kids came about 14 years ago. In 2003, we were down there. And the director at the time, Jerry Schneider, says, hey, Sandra and I were going down and says, hey, Sandra, would you put together a birthday party? I don't know. You know, we were trying to still figure out birthdays and all that kind of stuff. It says, we just kind of want to have a birthday party for everybody. And we did that. And it was an interesting situation. We kind of had everything there, and the kids didn't really understand it because they hadn't been really given gifts before. And then when we had the bags with all the stuff in it, they didn't really realize that one time they got to keep it. And when they finally did, they all went to bed clutching it in their hands. It's been a long time since then, and we want to run a little clip of a couple of the kids this morning, and then I'll have a couple more things to say.
My name is Daniela Sevillano, I'm 21. I came here to the Hacienda when I was 8 years old. And last year I finished college. Then in October I started my culinary school. And I'm so thankful for God because He's been amazing with me and all the people who have been helping me and making me going on my life. And now that I have the opportunity to be in a culinary school, I'm so thankful for that and that I have God in my life.
Hi, my name is George. I am 18 years old. I just graduated the last July. I am studying in the Catholic University of Ibarra to be a systems engineer. And then my goal is to be a good professional. And I want to have a good grade this semester. And that is all. Thank you for praying for me and supporting me. It will help me to have a successful life.
And they're speaking in English as a second language, but that actually helps them down there in terms of their opportunities going forward. Jorge, now called George, in fact, as he picked his name to start with, because we weren't sure exactly what his name was, and he picked Jorge. Now that he's gotten some English, he wants to be called George. So I guess he's picked it twice. But, you know, we are doing the things that we intended to do with that mission, and those that were involved early on, and those of you that have given so many years, we are accomplishing what our mission was. We are taking kids off the street that by now would be dead on the street, I don't know, I can't imagine, and making them productive citizens. They're graduating from high school. I think one of them called it college, so don't get confused. She's graduating from high school, and one's going to culinary school, Leonella, and Jorge is going to George is going to a university there. Now, George is struggling with his grades, but Jonna says he has grown so much in the last semester. He gets on a bus at like 6 in the morning and comes back at 6 in the evening. It's a long day for him. And pray for him that we can get him through this. You know, they're just like the rest of our kids. We've raised them, they're disciples, they're growing, they all have struggles, and we're working with them, and we're doing the things to make them disciples of Christ and productive citizens in Ecuador, and we're gonna change Ecuador when it's all said and done. You know, the presentation in a couple weeks will give you some more information, but if you haven't been given to this mission, you know, we asked for a lot of money on March 5th, and this is what it's for. And you'll see some more information later, but we're doing what that mission was given to us, and the Lord sent us there. I am convinced of that. And we need support from every one of you. If you're new to this congregation, we need the support. We've had some leave that gave considerable to this work, so we've got, you know, those of you coming in, we need to help you, get you to help backfill some of that and make this goal this year. But I appreciate all that you've done, and I think we can all be grateful for what the Lord has given us down there and what we can do going forward as we continue to grow and bring more children in. If you all stand this morning and greet one another before we start the rest of the worship.
this you were called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you were like sheep going astray, but now you have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls.
As we continue our journey this morning, we consider the concept of covenant, that which we've just sung about. This passage is kind of an agreement for us in a way. We're familiar with negotiations, with deal making, and with contracts, but the Bible uses a stronger concept and a much richer word, that of covenant. A solemn, binding promise between two parties. We today sign contracts in ink always, not pencil, always ink, to show that it'll be permanent. But God seals his covenant in a much more permanent and personal way, and that is with the blood of Jesus. Let's take our offering as we consider that.
Oh, the blood, crimson love, price of life's demand. Shameful sin placed on him, the hope of every man. Oh, the blood of Jesus washes me. Oh, the blood of Jesus shed for me. What a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. Savior, Son, Holy One,
so here's the thing I bet you haven't thought about today. The odd rituals we see at weddings. Maybe somebody in the balcony thought of that. We do some weird things at weddings, right? Throwing rice. Where did that come from? Probably, they think, from ancient Romans. They would throw rice at the bride and the groom, and it was to symbolize fertility. Sort of a, may you have this many children. Which is why brides and grooms duck the rice, right? So who wants that many kids? But that ritual fell on hard times back in the 80s. I can actually remember when this happened, because it was, they thought that it was, the myth got out that it was dangerous for birds to eat the rice. The rumor started that when birds would eat rice, it would expand inside of them until the little birds just blew up. And there were reports that pastors were going outside of churches the morning after a wedding, and they were finding exploded birds all over the place. My kids were so disappointed when that didn't happen. We'd have a wedding, and the next day they'd be out looking for blown up birds. So, not true. At any rate, people began looking for other ways to celebrate a bride and groom as they left the church, and so sparklers became really popular. How many of you had sparklers at your wedding? I can't really see, so maybe nobody. Hold up a sparkler if you were. No. And I'm not sure that was really a good idea either, because we went from safe and organic to pyrotechnics. From may you be fertile to I hope this thing doesn't blow up in your face. I think that was the... Then, okay, it's not just us. The Irish have the tradition of tying the knot. They tie a knot around the clasped hands of the bride and groom, which is where we get our phrase, tie the knot. In Jewish weddings, the couple smashes a glass or smashes a champagne glass, wine glass, and everyone shouts mazel tov or good fortune. And one explanation for that ritual is that it's a reminder of the destruction of the temple. And that marriage is such a big deal in the Jewish faith and culture that it's almost as if you are rebuilding the temple one marriage at a time. It's kind of a sweet image. And then there's the African American tradition of jumping a broomstick. And the thinking here is that in the antebellum South, slaves were not permitted to enter into binding contracts like marriage, and so they would jump the broomstick to indicate they were making a permanent commitment to one another. Historians think that ritual may have roots in ancient Africa, but nobody really knows for sure. And then in remote regions of China, a barefooted new husband will pick up his wife and carry her across hot coals before they cross over to their threshold, presumably because that will make childbirth easier for her, which is probably why some guy invented the epidural. So that the thing that all these rituals have in common is they all have special meaning to the people who participate in. They don't possess any particular magic, but they are important because by doing them, people are making statements about things that matter to them. These old rituals are ways of connecting the past and the present and the future. The passage that we're going to look at today, and we're going to close out our journey series this morning, but the passage we're going to look at today, it contains a ritual that is just so bizarre. It makes all of these other rituals seem pretty tame and sensible. It's in Genesis chapter 15. Genesis chapter 15 is where we'll be, and we're going to start in verse 7, read down to verse 19. So you may have had some questions about this one before. If you ran across this one in some of your Bible reading and went, what was that about? You'll leave here today going, what was that about? So here we go. Verse 7. God also said to Abraham, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land and take possession of it. But Abram said, Lord, sovereign Lord, how can I know that I will gain possession of it? And so the Lord said to him, bring me a heifer, a goat, and a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon. Abram brought all these to God, cut them in two, and arranged the halves opposite each other. The birds, however, he did not cut in half. And then birds of prey came down on the carcasses, but Abram drove them away. So this goes on all day long, where Abram's sitting out here in the hot sun, the flies and the smell, and he's shooing away the birds that are coming down to eat these carcasses. Verse 12, as the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. And then the Lord said to him, know for certain that for 400 years your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and they will be enslaved and mistreated there. But I will punish the nation they serve as slaves, and afterwards they will come out with great possessions. You, however, will go to your ancestors in peace and be buried at a good old age. In the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here, for the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure. And when the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking firepot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abraham and said, to your descendants, I give this land from the Wadi of Egypt to the great river, the Euphrates. So that's pretty weird. What is up with all the dismembered animals and the special effects? Well, Abraham asks God for what seems like, I don't know, the eighth or ninth time here, how can I know? How can I be sure? He's still struggling with doubt about the promises of God, the promise of a child, the promise of a great, uncountable lineage, and in this particular instance, the promise of land. And here's the thing I want you to see. Abraham has asked God these questions before. He struggled with doubt. We have yet to see God grow weary of Abraham's doubt. You realize that? God has not gotten tired of the questions. God has not gotten tired of the doubt. And that's consistent throughout Scripture, which should be a great comfort to you and to me. What God does do here is to ramp up his reassurance with this bloody ritual. So let's look at that for just a second here. Did you notice that when God told Abraham to collect the animals, he didn't tell him what to do with them? He just said, get me a heifer and a goat and a ram and 3 years old and a couple of birds. But he didn't tell him what to do with the animals. Abraham just knew. He knew to cut the animals in half and separate the halves to create a path through the carnage. How did he know that? Well, because this was a really common ritual back in those days called cutting the covenant, or cutting a covenant. In that part of the world, in those days, when people wanted to make a binding agreement on some matter of great significance, this is how they would do it. They would slaughter an animal or several animals, and then the parties would walk barefooted through the blood in between the carcasses. And the point they were making was that if I don't keep up my end of this bargain, if I don't do my part of this, keep my part of this contract, if I don't keep this covenant, may what happened to these animals happen to me. Kind of puts signing your name at the end of a mortgage contract in perspective, doesn't it? And that helps explain why a thick and dreadful darkness came over Abram. He's about to cut a covenant with God Almighty. If he doesn't keep up his end of the contract, of the covenant, something really bad could happen to him, something like what happened to these poor animals. Why does God do this? What? Why does God require Abraham to participate in this fierce and violent ritual? Well, for the same reason we exchange rings and light unity candles and recite vows at weddings. Marriage is hard. I mean, that ring on your finger, that reminds you that on a specific day in the past, and there are days in your marriage when you need this reminder, this ring reminds you that you stood up in front of your family and your friends and God Himself, and you said, I take you to be my truthfully, lawfully wedded husband or wife, in sickness or in health, in richer or in poorer, for better or for worse, till death do us part. That's what you said. And so every time you look at this tight little gold or silver or platinum or whatever kind of metal ring you have on your finger, all of that is bound up in that little symbol to remind you of what you said and of what you did. And look, there are times when you really need that. Dietrich Bonhoeffer once told a couple that he was counseling, doing some premarital counseling. He was in prison. He was in a Nazi prison writing letters to this couple. And what he said to them was, let me make sure I get this right. He said, it is not your love that will save your marriage. It is your marriage that will save your love. What he meant was, it's that commitment that you're going to have to lean on sometimes to save your marriage, to save the love that you have for each other. So that's why God is doing this. God knows that people get tired. God knows that the journey is long and that people get tired on that journey and that sometimes we forget. In fact, in verse 7 there in Genesis 15, he reminds Abraham of where it all began. I am the Lord who brought you out of the Ur of Chaldees. I mean, that seems like such a long time ago. For us, it's been a month that we've been in this series talking about all this stuff. For Abraham, this had been years. And what he doesn't know yet, he's about to find out when God talks to him in the middle of this bloody ritual. What he's about to find out is that he has only taken the first faltering steps in this journey. Beginning in verse 13, God reveals to him that this journey is not going to be measured in months. It's not going to be measured in years. It's not going to be measured in decades. It's going to be measured in centuries. God says, Abraham, generations from now, your descendants, and there will be a lot of them, your descendants generations from now are going to be strangers in a country not their own. They'll endure hard times for 400 years. And then after that, they will come out with great possessions. And I will give them this land. But Abraham, we're talking hundreds of years. Before that long journey is complete, you're going to die. An old man, blessed, very blessed, and at peace. See, you and I are not the first to struggle with impatience. We are not the first to ask God, are we there yet? Long before our grandfathers were a gleam in our great-grandfather's eyes centuries ago, Abraham was already getting tired on a journey that had just begun. And you and I get tired on that journey of faith too. Tired of not seeing the results we expect, of not getting the answers we want to the prayers that we pray, tired of being blindsided by the same old temptations. Do you get tired of that too? Tired of singing songs that we never quite live up to? Tired of serving people but not seeing lives change? We need to know what Abraham had to learn, that the journey is going to last longer than we do, and that what we do now, whether we act in faith or faithlessness, will have enormous consequences. Even though this journey is going to last longer than the youngest person in this church. You remember last week when we had all the babies up here? The journey that we are on, this walk of faith, is going to last longer than the youngest baby that was up here last week. This journey is going to last longer than the babies that are gesticulating in this very moment in their mother's wombs in this room. This journey is going to last longer unless Jesus comes back than the babies who have babies who have babies. It just takes a long, long time. And what we do, even though the journey is long, matters. On April 21st, 1855, a man named Edward Kimball stood outside a shoe store in Boston, Massachusetts, hesitating. A boy from his Sunday school class worked in the shoe store, and Kimball was really certain that he wasn't getting through to the boy. In fact, he knew he wasn't getting through to the boy, and he suspected it was because he wasn't a very good teacher. But God had really put it on his heart to reach out, not just to this boy, but to all the boys in his class, and so he was visiting the boys outside of Sunday school during the week to try and encourage them and to get the Lord into their lives. And so Kimball walked into the shoe store, and he found the boy in a back room boxing up shoes, and he laid a hand on his shoulder, and in very simple terms, he just urged him to follow Christ with all his heart. And to his surprise, the boy looked up and made a commitment to, in fact, permit the Lord Jesus to be the master of his life. The boy's name was Dwight Moody. Moody grew so much in his faith that he became a very effective evangelist. He actually founded Moody Bible Institute in Chicago. And in the early 1870s, while he was preaching in Britain, he met a young minister. Moody met a young British minister named F.B. Mayer. Mayer was inspired by Moody's preaching to become an evangelist himself. So in one of his sermons in the U.S., Mayer challenged his audience with this question. It's a great question. If you are not willing to give up everything for Christ, are you willing to be made willing? If you are not willing to give up everything for Christ, are you at least willing to be made willing? That remark hit one young man named J. Wilbur Chapman so hard that he gave his life to Christ, and he became a preacher. And Chapman traveled all over the world preaching about Jesus. And he would hold these weeks-long crusades in major cities. And of course, anytime you hold a big, long crusade like that, where you're meeting every night, it takes a lot of volunteers to help set it up and handle everything. And one of the volunteers that worked in Chapman's crusades was named Billy Sunday. Night after night, in city after city, Billy Sunday would stand off stage and watch J. Wilbur Chapman preach. And he learned how to preach by watching him. And when Chapman retired, Billy Sunday took over his ministry and became one of the most charismatic preachers in the country. Billy Sunday preached a revival in Charlotte, North Carolina in 1932. There was a group of businessmen who attended that revival, and they were so caught up in this message of Jesus that they started a prayer group, the purpose of which was to ask God to bring Christ to their city. And so they prayed every day at lunch. This group of businessmen would meet together in downtown Charlotte every day for lunch and pray. And out of those prayers, they got the idea to invite an evangelist named Mordecai Ham to come and preach a series of sermons in Charlotte. So Ham came in, and every night he preached. And every night during the meeting, a lanky 16-year-old sat in the crowd listening to the message of Jesus. And then one night, he gave his life to Christ, and his name was Billy Graham. Edward Kimball had no way of knowing the twists and turns the journey would take, but he had a tremendous impact on how it unfolded. By the time fruit was born from that one moment when he stepped in that door of that shoe store, he was dead. But he had made a difference. You and I may never see what is around some distant bend in the road for this church, but what we do now matters. That's why God required Abraham to observe that bloody ritual, to cut the covenant. That unforgettable experience would stay with him when the journey seemed too long to endure. But there's something about that unsettling experience that I haven't told you. In verse 17, when the sun sets, while that thick and dreadful darkness still envelops Abraham, he sees what Genesis calls the smoking fire pot and the blazing torch. Smoke and fire in the Bible, all through Scripture, are representations of God. The smoking pot and the blazing torch pass between the slaughtered animals, and as they do, God repeats his promise to give Abraham descendants and to give his descendants the land. But now here's the strange part. Abraham is a party to this covenant, but he is not required to walk the bloody path to seal it. God, in the symbols of that smoking pot and flaming torch, God is the only one who passes through the carnage to close the deal. Abraham is the beneficiary of this covenant through sheer grace. Anybody ever tells you there's no grace in the Old Testament? Hasn't read the Old Testament. It's as if God is saying, look, you and I both know there is no way that you and your descendants are going to be able to live up to the demands of this covenant. There will be seasons when you are faithful and fearless and committed, but they will be followed by seasons of sin and forgetfulness and outright rebellion. You cannot walk this journey blamelessly, so I'll stand in for you. I'll take your place. I will do what is necessary to cover you when you fail. As far as we know, Abraham never witnessed another cutting of the covenant. But this is not the only time God cut one. The prophet Isaiah looked forward and saw another. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows, yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. John, the apostle, said that Jesus is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Paul reminded us that everyone who fails to do everything written in the book of the law is cursed, but Jesus redeemed us from the curse by becoming the curse for us, in Galatians chapter 3. The Hebrews writer says that Jesus sacrificed for our sins once for all when he offered himself. So just as God did before Abraham, Jesus walked the bloody path to do for us what we could not do for ourselves. And every Sunday, when we come together, we share in a thing called communion, which in a lot of ways is like a wedding ring for our faith. It's the reminder through this pinch of cracker and this swallow of grape juice that a covenant was cut for us by God, and that Jesus himself walked the bloody path so we wouldn't have to. Because the truth is, we couldn't have done it anyway. Now, if you're a guest this morning, this may seem sort of odd and unusual to you, but you're welcome to join us as we share in this ceremony, this ritual. The bread that will be passed first represents the body of our Savior. We remember that he came in physically among us, that he shared a body with us, and that he suffered. And that cup, it's gruesome, but it's a reminder of his blood that he sacrificed for us. Let's sing about the cross, then we'll pray, then we'll remember. Let's pray. Father, it is one of the mysteries of our faith that you were able to squeeze all of your divinity into the body of a baby. And then the stories about his growing into a man and being tired or hungry or sleepy, or experiencing pain, brings home to us all the more that he lived among us as one of us, that you lived among us as one of us. And God, that perspective on the cross is painful. It's hard to look at because it means that what he felt was real. That he felt the nails and the thorns. He tasted the thirst, and he heard the jeers and the laughter. And yet he did it, you did it for us. You sealed that covenant with his suffering for us. God, we remember, and we are grateful for this bread, this symbol of his body. In Jesus' name, amen.
his head. Let's pray again. So, Lord, we don't like to see blood. We don't even like to talk about it. It is scary and gross. And yet every week you put it in front of us. You don't want us to forget. You want us to remember that Jesus was not just flesh, but flesh and blood, and that the sacrifice he made was not neat and clean and pretty. You remind us that our sin is truly worse than we think, because this is what was required. And you remind us through this sacrifice that your love is truly greater than we imagine, because this is what was done. So thank you. Help us to look at it and to realize what it means, and let that meaning change us. In Jesus' name, amen.
I just want to challenge you to do something this week. Today, let's start today. If you've got stuff that's in your past, the shame and the guilt of it, just you carry it around with you, you drag it around like a ball in a chain. Can I just invite you to leave that with Jesus? Leave it at the cross. That's what that's there for. If you got stuff you need to deal with now, let's deal with it. But realize you don't have to drag that shame and guilt around with you. You can be free of that. And then let's do this too. Let's let him have the past. Amen. Okay? But let's let him have the future. He's got it. He's already there. He's been there. He knows what's going to happen. We don't have to fight it or fight for it or protect it or he'll handle that. Let's you and me just be faithful today and trust the journey to him. Can we do that? Let's just try that. So look through the bulletin. There are like five or six things in there that you need to know about. Okay? So you should read that. All right. The one thing I will say is that we've got the spring tonight at 5 o'clock. In here or downstairs?
No, here.
Here. Well, he says here, and that's down, but... In here, the spring at 5 o'clock, that's our instrumental time of praise. It's awesome time to come together. Great thing to bring some friends to. Glenn, can you come on up and be ready to lead us into closing prayer? And before you leave, don't forget to stop by and check out our new... We haven't named this area out here yet, okay? So, the new area. Sit down, have a cup of coffee with somebody, and build relationships there. We'll tell you more about that a little bit later on. So glad you were here. Let's stand. Glenn's going to lead us into closing prayer.
Our Father, in our goal-oriented society, we are so focused on the destination that we often neglect the joys and the experiences of the journey. So, Father, today, I just pray that you'll give us a deeper sense of trust in you. Help us, Father, to appreciate the triumphs of life that we may experience. Help us, Father, to appreciate the setbacks, the difficulties. Because it's in those moments, Father, that we realize that we do not walk our journeys alone. Father, help us to realize that you have, by the blood of your Son, taken care of the ball and chain that we carry. Help us to let go of that weight, Father, and just walk today with our eyes focused on you. Through Jesus we pray. Amen.